In part 5 of my UI UX design crash course series, we will cover design aspects for various devices. In the past, most of the time we only had to consider only designing for desktop computers. But in today's era of wearables, smartphones, laptops, tablets and more, our situation is much more complicated. To navigate this challenge, designers have primarily taken two routes: adaptive and responsive design. Responsive design revolves around a single layout that adjusts the content, menus, and other design elements based on the user's screen size. With responsive design, you create a versatile layout where all design components adapt to the device resolution, be it a desktop, tablet, or mobile device. In contrast, adaptive design is about creation of dedicated layouts for specific screen sizes. Unlike the flexibility of responsive design, adaptive design requires multiple versions of a design. As you can guess, adaptive design demands extra effort, as you will need to design unique layouts for different resolutions or devices. This implies additional work for developers too, who must code for every separate resolution or device, as opposed to one flexible code that can adapt the layout. So you might wonder why opt for an adaptive approach that demands extra work when you can create a versatile, responsive one. The answer lies in the context of your product. Although adaptive design requires more effort, it lets you create specialized and more optimized user experiences for each platform. Responsive design sets rules to adapt your design to various use scenarios, which may not always be the ideal solution. So, when does an adaptive design approach shine? Adaptive design excels for web applications destined for different platforms like iOS, Android, and desktop. Leading web applications like Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube are perfect examples. Apart from that, an adaptive approach is also useful for upgrading existing sites to be mobile friendly. This gives you control over design and development for specific viewports. Responsive design may not offer as much control as adaptive, but it requires less effort to create and maintain. That's why most websites and apps today are built with responsive approach. Aside from responsive and adaptive approaches, sometimes you can also hear about fluid design. So, what it is? Fluid design can be considered a part of the responsive design strategy. With adaptive design, we plan dedicated screens for 6 common screen widths. The layout that a user sees depends on their available screen space and doesn't change once loaded. Responsive design can also use the same 6 common screen widths as breakpoints, but the layout adjusts to the maximum available screen real estate. A common example is the 12-column layout, where you place design elements within these columns. The elements of the user interface contract, expand, and rearrange based on the available space. Fluid design uses a similar concept, but instead of defined pixel values, it works with percentages in relation to other user interface elements. So rather than a container with a defined size dependent on the given breakpoint, it has a percentage value relative to other elements. Now, let's move to practical application. Our focus will be on the responsive approach, given it's the most popular one. However, before we start the design process, we need to plan our strategy. Do we start from a mobile perspective and then scale up the interface? Or should we commence with the desktop view and scale down to accommodate mobile devices? Scaling down is often referred to as graceful degradation or desktop-first approach, while scaling up is called progressive advancement or mobile-first design. One disadvantage of the desktop-first strategy is that many interface elements don't transition well to smaller screens, affecting aesthetics and functionality on smaller devices. The mobile-first methodology, on the other hand, pushes us to design first for smaller screens, effectively optimizing the experience. I recommend adopting the mobile-first approach if your project allows it. Assuming that we start with mobile, we must define the minimum resolution our design will cater to, focusing specifically on the narrowest width. We will do the same for tablet and desktop views as well. This minimum width values will act as breakpoints for our layouts. A breakpoint is a screen size limit set by specific layout demands. At a particular breakpoint range, the layout adjusts to the screen size and orientation. Next, we need to devise our responsive layout grid, which consists of 3 components: columns, gutters, and margins. Content is allocated to the screen areas containing columns. For responsive layouts, column widths should be defined with percentages instead of fixed values to allow content adaptability to any screen size. A gutter represents the space between columns that help segregate content. Gutter widths remain constant at each breakpoint range. To better adjust to a specific screen size, gutter widths can vary across different breakpoints. Margins are the spaces between content and the left and right screen edges. Margin widths are determined using fixed or scaling values at each breakpoint range. The margin width can change at different breakpoints to adapt better to the screen. For our mobile view, I will use 16 pixels for both margins and gutters and 4-column layout with a maximum width of 375 pixels as the breakpoint. For the tablet view, I will use 32 pixels for margins and gutters, a 6-column layout and 768 pixels as the breakpoint. For desktop, I will use the same size for margins and gutters, a 12-column layout, and a maximum width of 1280 pixels. With these specifications for the three most common use cases, I now have a fundamental responsive layout grids to follow while designing. For most projects, this should suffice. Now, let's start designing the first layout. As you can see, I have filled the previously defined 4-column layout with website content. The next task is to translate this layout to tablet and desktop variants. Starting with the 4 mobile columns, you can see how we can extend them to broader resolution by populating and optimizing the layout further. This process is commonly referred to as layout stacking or folding. You can envision the desktop view encompassing 3 of the 4-column mobile views, and the tablet view encompassing the 4 mobile columns within its 6 columns. As you can see, the most vital aspect of responsive design is an accurate definition of layout grids and stacking or folding behavior. In the next part of this course, we will cover visual styles and trends.